studied in Rome at the Pontifical Urban University of Urbaniana, where he was ordained in 1971. From 1971 to 2009, he held many pastoral, academic, and administrative positions and was professor at the Urbaniana. His last assignment included the post of consultant for the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue and president of the Xuanlong Major Seminary since 2009, and coordinator of the apostolate among Vietnamese in the diaspora. He has written numerous articles and essays devoted to missionary spirituality and the prospects for evangelization in Africa. But for our purposes, I would like to present him as the mentor of Mother Jess in her licensing and doctorate degree. And he was instrumental in for Mother Jess to finish her dissertation because he was her advisor in the writing of her dissertation. Let us all please welcome in our midst His Excellency, the Most Reverend Joseph Lin Doc Zhao, Bishop of Xuanlong and Rector of the Major Seminary. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Monsignor. The last title is the most important, and that is he says a mentor of the doctorate thesis of Mother Jess. That is the most important title over all other titles. Excellencies, senior, your fathers, and the sisters, Mother Jess, and everybody. Our Bishop Dominic has given the welcome to you, and I also want to repeat that welcome to you all to our diocese. We are really very glad. We will be enriched by your presence, by your reflections, in your visit in different parishes. Your presence will transmit your faith to our people. We wish also to contribute something for your reflection, for your faith experience, that we do expect to be more, that your presence, your faith, will enrich our people. The title, the theme assigned to me today is Missionary Catechesis in the Context of the Church in Vietnam. The theme is very scholarly phrase, but I do not want to present a scholarly disposition of the theme. I would like to present faith, a spiritual challenge. Very simple, as you can see already in the papers, the sheets you have before you. Very simple. It is a more of faith experience, faith sharing, than abstract theological reflection. When we talk of the missionary cases, missionary mission, I don't want to enter into a long discussion about the meaning of the mission. I only take a very simple aspect, that is something to work in the midst for the non-Christians, the presence of the non-Christians. Therefore, first of all, I would like to present to you, you may have read already, but now to have a concrete vision of the missionary situations, I call missionary situation in statistics, in numbers. The first moment I offer you have there in the sheets before your eyes. the statistics, general statistics of the world, you know, the church. If we look at the statistics of religions, we will see immediately the questions, very serious situation of the mission. We just look at the first statistic of a religion in the year 2000. World population was 6,085,572,000 persons. In the Christian population, all Catholic, Protestants, Orthodox, altogether were 2,013,132,000. It means in the year 2000, there were still 4 billion people did not know Christ, who he is. In the mid-2014, the number of the non-Christians, that is, those who do not know Christ as the Savior, when we proclaim Christ is our Savior and the Savior of the world, there are 4,507,170,000 people. And following the development of the population as it is now, when we reach the year 2025, the number of those who do not know Christ as the Savior, who may have, who may hear the name of Christ, even read Gospels, but they do not know that Christ is not only the Savior of the Christians, but their Savior. In the year 2025, those non-Christians who reach the number of 5,002,635,000 persons. And then after that you have the statistics of different religions. You will see that now the Catholic is not the most populous religion anymore. This is a question of 20 years ago. Now if you look at the statistics of the Catholic Church, I have the last statistic, but anyways already on 2 years ago. We look immediately to our continent, Asia. The population grew, because it was 2013, more than a year ago. Asia, the population was 4,202,786,000 persons. The Catholics were 132,238,000 persons, among which you have already about 60 million who are concentrated in the Philippines. The half of this number is divided into the whole continent of Asia. So we see the situation is really a challenge. Now if you want to have a close look at the church in Vietnam, I also offer you a statistic realized by the Secretariat of the Bishops' Conference 2 years ago. This year, we are still elaborating. I would like to invite you to look immediately at number 24, that is the place where you stay now, the Diocese of Solo, is the diocese most Catholic in Vietnam. In Solo, we have 3,175,800 persons, and the Catholic are 921,489 persons. That is around 30%. In other places, if you look at the number 2, Lạc Sơn, you see that the presence of the Catholic Church is really minimum, with a population of 1,760,000 7,308 persons. The Catholics are only 5,661. So this is the situation in Vietnam. I don't want to read all the numbers you have before your eyes, because if I read all the diocese, it would take us too much time. So we didn't get time for some other things, because the number, we can read it after. I mean, just to look at the total. So the population of Vietnam 1 year ago were 95,247,775 persons, and the Catholic are only 6,606,495 persons. And Vietnam is now the third country in percentage. There are more Catholics in percentage after the Philippines and the Korea. South Korea. The South Korea is about 10%. In Vietnam, we are about 7%. That's the third time. So we see here clearly a challenge. And the situation of the mission in the world in general, but particularly in Asia and in Vietnam, require much reflection and commitment. The question I would like to ask here is, what is the core aspiration of the people, Catholics and non-Catholic, non-Christians? The needs, the requirements are many, but we cannot respond to all the requirements, all the needs of the people. So the question we have to ask is, what is the most essential, most profound need, the feeling of the people in Asia, I would say in particular way in Vietnam? I would like to answer this question by two facts. One is my pastoral experience as a bishop. And the second answer I take from the exhortation Evangelium Sandy of Pope 46. The first element for the answer is my many experience as bishop, because I must go to many parishes. We have about 260 parishes in the diocese. And the 3 months, three almost 4 months, June, July, August, and half September, are the months of the confirmation. The Bishop Dominic and myself, we have to go to visit the parishes almost every day. Every day we have to go to a parish. Now, after 2 years, I haven't gone through on the parishes with the diocese. And in these visits to the parishes, I have two particular experiences. The first one, I went to visit a hospital. I entered into a room where there were six people. Among them, one were Buddhist and 4 were Catholics. And among the Catholics, there was one man who was there with a broken leg because he went to the Mass early in the morning and went back. He got an accident. Someone drove upon him, so he was broken at his leg. He's still there with the leg up there. And I enter into the room and I greeted everybody. All people, including the Buddhists, were very happy to see the bishop. And at some moment, I gave everybody a rosary. This is my habit. children a rosary. And I have always have a rosary with me in my family. So I give everybody a rosary. And the man with the broken leg shouted, "I'm so lucky, never lucky as today. If I am not broken the leg, how can I see the vision? How can I receive this gift with a rosary?" Even with a broken leg, he was so happy because he was visited by a bishop and received a rosary, a small gift. He can buy it in other shops. But his question is a gift for the bishop. Why? The bishop is a man, is everybody. But the people do not see bishop as a man, but a man of God. That is why he shouted with joy, "I never have lucky as today. If I am not broken in my life, how can I see the vision?" Because when the people are many, we go to the parishes, go through creating somebody, but never, I cannot stay there, speak with everybody, just greeting them and go, because there are many people. But now, when he's there, they can talk and ask why, etc. If he's so lucky, that is the first experience which says something. The second experience, that is the day of Christmas Day. In the afternoon,